Good evening, everyone. Today, my topic is about BRCA testing, the magic bullet in personalizing treatment in ovarian cancer. So we'll be briefly talking about ovarian cancer and the relevance of BRCA gene mutation, why we should be testing it, who are the patients that we should be testing BRCA gene, what is the timing for the test, which sample to test, and what the current guideline recommendations are. So as you all know, for ovarian cancer and BRCA in ovarian cancer, this is a graph that we are very familiar with during our treatment of patients with ovarian. When we see stage 3 and stage 4 patients, we do know that more than 80% of the patients will recur at some point during their lifetime. And we keep treating them with one treatment after the other. And the median progression-free survival decreases with each recurrence. So I think that today's conversation is about, is there anything we can do to improve this progression-free survival? The future speakers will be talking more in detail about that. I will talk about the relevance of BRCA mutation in improving this progression-free survival. As we also know, BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutation patients have a higher risk of developing cancers compared to the general population. So the common cancers that we see are breast, ovarian, prostate, and pancreatic cancer. Patients with BRCA1 mutation have a higher risk of breast and ovarian compared to BRCA2 mutations. But even here, the percentage is quite high. Ovarian cancer lifetime risk is 39% in BRCA1 patients and 11% in BRCA2 patients. So testing for BRCA has implications in clinical practice in many different settings. One is treatment decisions. So again, we know that patients who are BRCA mutation positive are more sensitive to platinum-based chemotherapy. So we might, even if a patient can't afford PARP inhibitors, we might be using the BRCA testing in different malignancies to see if we should be maybe giving more platinum-based. And rather than ovarian, we do this more in breast cancers, triple negative, where if it's a BRCA negative patient, we might prefer a platinum-based treatment. In patients with pancreatic and prostate cancers also, if they're BRCA positive, we might be leaning more towards a platinum-based treatment. BRCA testing also will tell us who is suitable for the PARP inhibitor therapy. Second is the prognostic factor. And in ovarian cancer, having a BRCA mutation, there's a slightly better prognosis independent of the stage and histology and the extent of surgical debulking. So that way also BRCA mutation will be helpful. And last but not the least, BRCA mutation can help us identify those women who are at increased risk of ovarian and breast cancer, and to counsel family members when you have a germline mutation on what are the tests that need to be done and what are the precautions that need to be taken and what are the different preventive strategies that are there. So knowing the BRCA mutation status is not just for PARP inhibitors, but has broader implications also in clinical practice. So coming to the referral criteria, who are the patients that we will be testing BRCA mutation? So during our PG time, which is very, very long ago, there were strict criteria on having a particular kind of family history. We would look at how many first generation members had a family history, what was the age, was it a very young patient, and based on the histological type. So which of these do we use today to decide on who we should be doing BRCA testing for? Do we go with the family history? Do we say the younger the patient, we should be doing it? Is it only patients with high-grade serous carcinomas that we will be testing? So what we have learned over time is that even patients who do not have any family history, we can see BRCA mutations in them. And this, I think, we are all familiar with now in our clinical practice, where patients will say nobody in their family has ovarian cancer, but when we do the BRCA mutation test, surprisingly, it will come positive. Even the germline mutation comes positive. So BRCA mutations may be present in 15 to 44% of the individuals with no family history of ovarian and or breast cancer. So we cannot rely just on family history to decide on who we should be testing these patients for. Well, what about age? And again, initially we were taught that younger the patient, maybe the higher the risk of a familial cancer, and we should be testing only the younger women with for mutation. But now we know that even in older patients, we do see BRCA mutations. So the highest incidence of ovarian or peritoneal cancer BRCA mutation was seen in those above the age of 50 years. So here you can see in this graph, in the 50 to 59 year age group, the annual risk is 1.68 in BRCA1 mutation, and the 60 to 69 is 0.92. So even if a patient is older, considering the treatment options that we have today and the prognostic implications, we should be looking at testing all patients with BRCA mutation. So not just family history and age, because in many of the times patients will not have either of these. So we might be missing up to 40% of the patients if we just go with these two criteria. So we should be looking at testing all our patients for BRCA mutation in ovarian cancer. What about histology? And high grade serous is where it is the most common that we see most of the BRCA mutations in. But we have to remember that even in other histologies, we see in low grade serous, we do see in endometrioid and clear cell up to 10% of the patients might have BRCA mutation. So it is definitely worthwhile checking, because we now have good treatments available for these patients with the mutation. So if you don't have a high grade also, we should be checking for them. When do we test? Do we test at the time of diagnosis? Do we test at the time of recurrence? Do we test when we have finished chemotherapy for these patients? And ASCO has recently published the guideline for BRCA testing in ovarian cancers. And the recommendation is that women with epithelial ovarian cancer should be offered testing at the time of diagnosis. And this is something that almost all guidelines are now stating, regardless of the country and which side of the Atlantic you're in, that at the time of the diagnosis is the best time to test for these BRCA tests, because of the therapeutic implications, which the other speakers will talk about. So which sample do we test? Do we test the tumor or do we test the blood? So as you know, there are two types of mutations. One is called a germline mutation and the other one is a somatic mutation. So germline mutation is something that is transmitted from parent to offspring, whereas somatic mutation is something that is acquired during the individual's life. So it will be present only in the tumor cell and not in all the entire tissue of the patient. So should we be testing both or not? And like the future speakers will tell about how there is a benefit from PARP inhibitors, in equal benefit, but regardless of whether a patient has a germline or a somatic testing, it is recommended now that we should be testing the patients for both these. So how do we test that? If we do a blood test, it will be mainly the germline testing that we will detect. If we do a tumor test, we can detect all the BRCA mutations, but we will not know whether that particular mutation is a somatic or a BRCA mutation. For that particular patient, it does not matter, because if the tumor is showing a BRCA mutation, then we can start PARP inhibitors for these patients. But for implications to the rest of the family members, it might be important to know whether that mutation is a somatic mutation or a germline mutation. So in the tumor cells, we can see either somatic or germline mutations. If we do a blood test, then only germline mutations will be detected. So what is the percentage of patients who have these somatic mutations? And approximately 9% of the patients do, up to 9% of the patients can have somatic BRCA mutations. So it is very important to test for somatic BRCA also, because we don't want to miss this group of patients. So this is a multiple studies where they looked at women with epithelial ovarian cancers to see what the frequency of somatic mutations is, and it is between 5 to 9%. One question is, should we do only tumor mutation? That way we know we will catch everybody who has a BRCA mutation. But again, it's important to remember that when we do somatic mutation testing on the tissue, we usually miss around 5 to 7% of patients who have germline mutation. And the other part is also true. If we do only germline mutation testing, then we will be missing these 5 to 9% patients who have somatic mutations done. And all these studies, the studies where they have looked at olaparib maintenance, niraparib or rucaparib, everywhere, regardless of whether the mutation is a germline or a somatic, the degree of benefit that we are getting is the same. So the hazard ratios are strikingly similar, regardless of whether it is a germline or a somatic. So it is not that patients who have somatic mutation will benefit less from these drugs. So it is important to do both the tests. So what are the current guideline recommendations? The NCCN guideline recommends that all patients with ovarian cancer, fallopian tube cancer, or primary peritoneal cancer should have testing done for BRCA mutations. And this would be both germline and somatic. It is the similar guidelines in ESMO, where they say that definitely germline testing should be done and consideration should be given for somatic BRCA mutation. ASCO, as we discussed, again recommends germline mutation. And the sequence in ASCO recommendations, it's the check for germline, and if that's negative, to go for somatic mutation testing. But the testing has to be done at some point for the patient. And the SGO recommendation is BRCA testing for all patients with epithelial, ovarian, and peritoneal cancer, regardless of the family history. So I will stop there and not go into details of variants of unknown significance, because I don't think it is important for us for this particular talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Moving on to the next speaker. The next speaker for today is Dr. Maya Lakshmi, medical oncologist from Hyderabad. Ma'am, requesting you to share your screen.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Sudha Madam, for the nice talk. And now I'll be discussing the role of olaparib in the frontline treatment of ovarian cancer. We'll be discussing mainly in the newly diagnosed ovarian cancer. Are my slides moving?
No, ma'am. Ma'am, we can see your slides, but they're not moving. Ma'am, can you try using the arrow keys?
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Please wait. I'll start sharing again. Now? Yes. Now you are able to see the other slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I'm sorry. So quickly, we'll rush through the background of ovarian cancer. As ma'am has already discussed, the treatment of ovarian cancer, there's a lot of unmet need because, you know, the outcomes are dismal in spite of all the advances in management. This graph has already been shown that with each recurrence, there's decrease in the PFS. So we'll be discussing today about two main trials in the frontline management of ovarian cancer. One is a solo one, where olaparib is compared to placebo in BRCA mutated ovarian cancer patients. Other is the Paola trial. These are the two studies which we are going to discuss. This is a solo one trial, where this is a study of maintenance therapy with a PARP inhibitor in newly diagnosed ovarian cancer. This is a study inclusion where all the newly diagnosed and people stage 3, stage 4, high-grade, serous, or endometrioid ovarian cancer, or primary peritoneal or fallopian tube cancers are included into the study. Those patients only who have germline or somatic BRCA mutation are included with the good PS and after surgery, either the patients underwent upfront surgery or after a platinum-based chemotherapy. These patients are randomized in a 2:1 fashion to olaparib 300 mg BID or placebo. And the treatment of olaparib is continued till 2 years. In patients with no evidence of disease at 2 years, the treatment of olaparib is discontinued. And patients who had a partial response at 2 years, they are continued with olaparib. So the primary endpoint is progression-free survival. These are the study population where all the baseline characteristics are well matched in all the treatment groups. You can see that and after treatment of platinum-based chemotherapy, around 80% had complete response. And one of the most common serous histology, 90% had serous histology, and BRCA1 was mutated in around 70%, and BRCA2 in around 25%. If you see this, after upfront surgery, residual macroscopic disease was seen only around 23%, and in 76%, there is no residual macroscopic disease. After interval cytoreductive surgery, there is residual macroscopic disease in around 19%. So if you see this graph, around 42%, they discontinue treatment before 2 years, but more than 50% in olaparib arm completed the protocol-defined treatment. Coming to the primary endpoint of progression-free survival, the median PFS in the olaparib arm is around 56 months, and the placebo arm is 13.8 months with a hazard ratio of 0.33. So if you see at around 60 months, 48% are progression-free at 5 years, almost during nearly more than twice compared to the placebo arm. So olaparib reduced the risk of progression or death by around 67%. If you see the PFS2, there is a benefit even in the PFS2 and time to second subsequent treatment. If you see the PFS2 curves, the hazard ratio is around 0.46, and time to second subsequent treatment hazard ratio is around 0.46. So the major adverse effects with olaparib are GI disturbances, fatigue, and anemia. In this graph, we are not seeing about second malignancies, but in SOLO-1, around 1% had a history of MDS and AML. It's less than 1%. But the most common, their majority of patients tolerated well. The most common nausea, followed by fatigue, and vomiting and anemia. These are the most common adverse effects. So the messages from SOLO-1 trial are, maintenance olaparib leads to substantial improvement in PFS in newly diagnosed ovarian cancer patients who are BRCA mutated. The difference in median PFS around 3 years. There is 66% reduction in the risk of progression or death with olaparib compared to placebo. The median PFS was around 56 months on olaparib versus 13.8 months with placebo. And even a reduction in the risk of second progression or death was observed, demonstrating that olaparib maintenance does not diminish the benefit conferred by subsequent therapy. So coming to the next study, there is the PAOLA-1. We have seen that the comparator arm in the SOLO-1 is the placebo. But unlike SOLO-1, there is an effective comparator arm, that is bevacizumab, in this PAOLA-1 trial. This trial included all patients, FIGO stage 3 or 4, or high-grade ovarian serous or endometrioid. Even non-mucinous BRCA-mutated patients are also taken into study, who are surgery upfront or of an interval, who have received platinum-based chemotherapy and with at least more than 3 cycles of bevacizumab. These patients are randomized to olaparib 300 mg BID for 2 years plus bevacizumab or placebo plus bevacizumab. Bevacizumab was given for 15 months and olaparib for 2 years. The primary endpoint is progression-free survival. So there's an important difference between PAOLA-1 and the SOLO trial. This is PAOLA-1 is much more representative of the first-line patient population, and patients are now selected based on biomarkers or surgical outcomes or platinum responses, because in this study, not only patients who have responded, even those unresponders are also taken into study. And there's a pre-planned subgroup analysis based on tumor BRCA mutation, HRD, and HRR mutation status. And one more important point is that active maintenance bevacizumab arm. This is one study which, as we said, which has an arm which has an active drug. So again, the baseline characteristics are well matched in the both arms. Upfront surgery was 50% underwent upfront surgery in both arms. So if you see residual macroscopic disease, around 41% had residual macroscopic disease, which is much higher than the solo one study. So coming to disease progression was the most common reason for discontinuation. If you see disease progression as per research, around 60% discontinued treatment in the bevacizumab plus olaparib arm, compared to around 72% in the placebo arm. This is the primary endpoint. The median PFS is 22.1 month in the olaparib plus bev arm, compared to 16.6 month in the placebo arm. The hazard ratio 0.59. So if you see, there is all the study groups got benefited with the addition of olaparib. So the approximately 50%, if you see the pie chart, and 50% of the patient POLO1 were HRD positive. Tumor mutation, tumor BRCA mutated is seen around 30%, and the HRD testing was done by Myriad MyScore tumor assay, where a score of more than 42 is taken as positive. Around 48% were HRD positive. If you see this, the summary of key subgroup of PFS, there's the difference in median PFS. If you see, it's 5.5 months in the 5.5 months, and in the tumor BRCA mutated, the difference around 15.5 months. 5.5 months in the intent to treat population, 15.5 months in the tumor BRCA mutated group. In HRD positive group is around 19.5 months. When HRD unknown, the difference is not much. It is around 0.9 months. So there is benefit, more benefit in those patients who are tumor BRCA mutated or in any in those with HRD positive. So even olaparib, there is a significant reduction in the risk of second progression in the intent to treat population. If you see the PFS2, 36.5 months in olaparib plus bev arm, this has a hazard ratio of 0.78. So around 27% of patients in the placebo arm and 9% olaparib arm, they received a PARP inhibitor as a first subsequent treatment. So, and the addition of olaparib to bev enhanced the clinical response to first line treatment. And the oral response was highest in patients with BRCA mutated or those with HRD positive disease. If you see the adverse effects, and the adverse effects are also mild to moderate. As we discussed before, the most common adverse effects are the GI toxicity and the anemia. These are the toxicity profile, same as seen in the previous trials. Nausea, fatigue is the most common, higher, and anemia was also seen around 40%. And as I said, around 1% of patients had AML or MDS. This and even update analysis, there is no increased number of patients with AML. And in both arms, there is no significant difference in the quality of life. So the takeaway messages from the POLO study are that POLO 1 is the only phase 3 trial to investigate the addition of PARP inhibitor to active treatment with bevacizumab in the newly diagnosed setting. And this is a representative patient population unselected by biomarker status or surgical outcomes. Olaparib added to bevacizumab significantly improved PFS compared to placebo plus bev. And in HRD positive patients, olaparib added to bev substantially improved PFS compared to placebo plus bev with hazard ratio of 0.33. And with the median PFS of 37.2 months versus 17.7 months, demonstrating the importance of HRD testing in clinical decision making. Mm-hmm. The significant improvement in PFS2 demonstrated that olaparib added to bevacizumab was associated with a continued benefit beyond first progression. And as we all know, olaparib is also well tolerated, and there is no detriment in the health-related quality of life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Moving on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Anu Suzanne, medical oncologist from Cochin. Ma'am, requesting you to unmute. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Can you see the slides?
Yes, ma'am, we can see the slides.
Okay. So my topic is the role of PARP inhibitors in the maintenance treatment of recurrent ovarian cancer. So as the previous speaker has already shown the slide, but as we all know that almost 80% of the advanced ovarian cancers, they will recur after the first line treatment. And with each recurrence, as we know, the PFS keeps decreasing and the platinum sensitivity also changes to platinum resistance. So that is the reason why we require a maintenance treatment even in the recurrent setting. Among the ovarian gynecological cancers, we know that ovarian cancer has one of the worst prognosis, especially in the advanced stages. And the overall survival in the Indian patients is only about 28 months in stage 3 and 12 months for stage 4 patients. As we've already seen all these biomarkers, I'll not be going into that. So the two main trials which related to olaparib in the recurrent setting are SOLO-2 and Study 19. The main difference between these two trials, the SOLO 2 was a phase 3 trial, while Study 19 was a phase 2 trial. Both of them looked at platinum sensitive recurrent ovarian cancer, which had had more than two lines of platinum treatment before. One was selected for BRCA, the other was not selected for BRCA mutations. So looking at the Study 19 trial design, this included patients who were platinum sensitive, high grade serous ovarian cancers who had had at least two lines of platinum based chemotherapy before. And the CA125 had to be below the upper limit of normal or stable at study entry. And the endpoints, the difference was the dosage of olaparib. In this, it was a 400 milligram BD dosage, which is the capsule. And the primary endpoint was the PFS, while the secondary endpoint was the OS. So this study showed a PFS benefit of almost double that for when compared to placebo. The PFS was 4.8 months versus 4.8 months for the placebo with 8.4 months for olaparib. The hazard ratio in the BRCA mutated population was 0.18 with a median PFS of 11.2 months. And the OS analysis at almost 80% maturity, though not statistically significant, it numerically favored olaparib with a median PFS of 29.8 months when compared to the placebo. And the hazard ratio is 0.73. Now looking at the SOLO 2 trial, which was the phase 3 trial of maintenance olaparib, this included both the high-grade serous ovarian cancer as well as high-grade endometrioid cancer, having had more than two lines of platinum-based chemotherapy before. They had to be in CR or PR following completion of at least four cycles of platinum-based chemotherapy, and they were stratified based on the platinum-free interval as well as the response to the previous therapy. And the dosage was 300 milligrams of olaparib BD. They were randomized 2:1, the primary endpoint being PFS, the secondary endpoints being PFS2 and OS. So this study also had some other special types of OS analysis was done to look at the effect of subsequent PARP inhibitor therapy, which is the RPSFT model. So to adjust for subsequent PARP inhibitor therapy. And they also had a post hoc ECRF OS analysis, which was for patients who were misstratified. The patients almost had similar baseline characteristics. Predominantly ovarian cancer was the primary tumor location, with about 16% patients having fallopian tube or primary peritoneal cancer. The predominant histology was serous, with a few patients having endometrioid histology as well. Most of them had a BRCA1 mutation, with almost 30% having BRCA2 mutations. Most of them had at least two lines of prior platinum, with some of them having three or four lines also. And the prior usage of bevacizumab was very minimal, with only 17% of patients having prior use of bevacizumab. So at the final data cutoff, almost 22% of patients remained on the olaparib arm. And it showed that there was significant extension of the PFS when compared with the placebo. There was a 70% reduction in the risk of progression or death when compared to the placebo, with a median PFS of 19.1 months, and the hazard ratio was 0.3. And the PFS2 also showed a consistent benefit where it was not reached in the olaparib arm, while in the placebo arm it was 18.4 months. The hazard ratio was 0.5. So it showed that there's a consistent benefit for olaparib even beyond progression. And the OS analysis, again, though it was not statistically significant, there was a clinically significant prolongation of OS with in the unselected population, it was 12.9 months. And the hazard ratio of 0.74. But when we look at the RPSFT model, again, it shows that it was significant with a hazard ratio of 0.56, and the median OS improved by 16.3 months when you adjust for subsequent PARP inhibitor-based therapy. The time to subsequent therapy was also significantly prolonged, as well as the almost 22% of patients continue to be on olaparib after five years. So, most of it, the patients had a tolerable side effects, with only about 17% of patients requiring treatment discontinuation because of the side effects. The predominant side effects, similar to SOLO-1, the side effects were mainly GI side effects like nausea and vomiting. But the most important grade 3 side effect was anemia. And regarding the concern with MDS, similar to the SOLO 1, had 1%, here was almost 16 patient of patients developed MDS and AML. 16 patients developed MDS or AML on olaparib therapy in this 5 years. But we need to look at more at the reasons why this is there, because whether it could be related to the BRCA mutations or the prior platinum treatment the patients received. The reasons are not clear. It requires further, we need to look further into that. Pneumonitis was seen in about 2% of patients. And in conclusion, the SOLO-2 is the first phase 3 trial of maintenance PARP inhibitors, which reported an OS benefit. Though which was not statistically significant, it was clinically significant with a prolongation of the median OS by 12.3 months. And as we know, the survival in even in ovarian cancer is very low. At 5 years, it was 46%, and all stages were included. But here, with advanced disease and recurrent disease, at 5 years, 42% of the patients were alive. And most of them could be, the 22% of patients could be on maintenance olaparib for more than 5 years. It shows as a fairly tolerable drug. Though there was a concern with MDS and AML, which requires further looking into. And almost the same slides in conclusion, I'd just like to point out that almost 11% of these patients continue to be on olaparib for more than 6 years. And of these, 7% were BRCA wild type. So irrespective of the BRCA mutation status, these patients, there were patients who had a benefit. They might have been homologous recombination or mutation deficient patients. I don't know that it was not tested in this particular study, but there is a benefit even in the BRCA unmutated type. So that's all about maintenance in recurrent setting. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Moving on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Smita Saldana, medical oncologist from Bangalore. Ma'am, requesting you to unmute yourself.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Yeah. So I should just share my screen.
Yes.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am, we can see your screen.
So thank you for this opportunity, for this wonderful discussion on Women Cancer Symposium. So I'll be basically talking about the local scenario, the treatment guidelines in advanced breast cancer, and the role of PARP inhibitors in metastatic breast cancer. So as we all know, the present situation, the breast cancer has been steadily increasing in number in our urban population. And we all know the 5-year survival rates are better in breast cancer when it is early breast cancer, approximately around 60%, but it falls to around 22% in stage 4 disease. And around 70 to 84% of our breast cancers are HER2 negative, almost 30% with triple negative breast cancer. And we all know the triple negative breast cancers when they are younger patients, and they can also harbor the BRCA mutations almost in 5 to 30%. There was a study which mentioned Asian data suggesting around 10.9 to 30.8% of BRCA mutation in triple negative breast cancer. And because of the tumor biology in the advanced breast cancer, the survival varies, and the hormone receptor negative, the HER2 negative, the triple negative breast cancer basically performs the poorest with the poorest overall survival. The hormone receptor positive and the HER2 negative does relatively very well. So there is a huge unmet medical need in the metastatic breast cancer, where the 5-year overall survival is only around 22%. There are phase 3 studies in metastatic breast cancer which has shown a median PFS with a standard single agent like eribulin, capecitabine or vidarubin approximately only around 4 to 5 months. There was an Indian study which did with the eribulin monotherapy which showed a median OS of around 6.2 months. And we also know we cannot use multiple agents because of the poor tolerability and excessive toxicity what they have. So olaparib offers a new targeted treatment for germline BRCA mutated patients with the HER2 negative breast cancer. Now, not all the metastatic breast cancer can reach the next line of therapy. So what we have seen is once around 1/3 of the patients stop their treatment once they reach the next line of therapy. And this was seen with a large retrospective cohort study over here. So in, as the lines progress, the third line, fourth line, the number of patients able to tolerate the chemotherapy subsequently reduces. So if we know the treatment guidelines in metastatic breast cancer, if it is in the hormone positive HER2 negative, we have a new armamentarium of drugs with the CDK4/6 inhibitors. So we have had palbociclib, ribociclib, abemaciclib in the recent past. And also in the median PFS to chemotherapy in metastatic breast cancer is around in the first line around 12 weeks, followed by 9 weeks in the second line chemotherapy. And then around four weeks once the person exposed to third line chemotherapy. Now, if you look at the treatment algorithm for the HER2 positive, HER2 negative, hormone receptor positive breast cancer, metastatic breast cancer, it depends on the patient with visceral crisis or no visceral crisis. So if the patient has visceral crisis, we'll prefer usually going with the chemotherapy. And there we may go for a single agent chemotherapy or you can go for a combination chemotherapy. Combination chemotherapy usually in case of rapid progression of the visceral crisis or the person has a huge tumor burden, we require to rapidly get the symptom control, then you'll prefer to go with a combination chemotherapy agent. If the person has been previously untreated, then you will go with the anthracycline or taxanes. If the person has been previously treated with anthracycline or taxane, you will go with the agents like capecitabine, eribulin or vinorelbin. And you'll continue till you get a maximum response or they have toxicity and then put them on a maintenance endocrine therapy. Whereas in triple negative breast cancer patients, in advanced triple negative, we'll always go for the first, do a genetic counseling and then do the BRCA mutation status. And then, you know, depending on the patient's visceral crisis, if the patient is in visceral crisis, you'll go with a chemotherapy. When there is a huge tumor burden or you require rapid symptom control, you'll go with a combination chemotherapy. And yeah, the preferred regimens are usually carboplatin, gemcitabine, or capecitabine or cisplatin-based chemotherapy. And if they are previously treated with anthracyclines or taxanes and they come back with a relapse, in such patients, again, you will do a BRCA mutation testing. If they are BRCA mutant, you'll go with the PARP inhibitor or you can go with carboplatin. If they are wild type, you'll again go with the other single agent like capecitabine, eribulin, or vinorelbin. And we have multiple options for the metastatic triple negative breast cancer. We have taxane with or without bevacizumab, the nab-paclitaxel, single agent platinum, the eribulin, capecitabine. Earlier days, I think a lot of people of us used ixabipilone. Now the usage is pretty less. Then vinorelbin with capecitabine. Then sometimes you may go with the CMF regimen. Now, what is the BRCA importance in your triple negative breast cancer? BRCA1 and BRCA2, as already it has been discussed, they are tumor suppressor genes. And the functional BRCA proteins regulate the cell growth and prevent the abnormal cell division, which leads to tumor development. So they say the tumorigenesis in germline inherited BRCA1 or 2 mutation carriers follows a two-hit hypothesis. The first hit being due to an inherited mutation of one BRCA allele. And when this already they have a mutated inherited mutation in the one BRCA allele, They have a second hit due to the inactivation of the second wild type allele. Then they'll have the onset of the tumor or the tumorigenesis. So in whom should you look for the BRCA mutation specifically in breast cancer? Women who have specific inherited mutations in the BRCA1 or BRCA2 have an increased risk of breast and ovarian cancers. So we will look at the Olympiad study design. So the Olympiad study design was basically, it was done around in almost 300 patients in a duration of around 1 to 2 years. So the target population were the HER2 negative metastatic breast cancer. They were either hormone receptor ER positive or PR positive or triple negative breast cancer. And they should have had the germline BRCA mutation positive. They could have been exposed to prior chemotherapy and prior platinum use. They were randomized 2:1 into olaparib 300 mg tablets twice daily versus the chemotherapy of treatment of physician's choice. The most of the agents were the capecitabine, eribulin or vinorelbine. And they looked at the primary endpoint, the progression-free survival, and the secondary endpoint was the time to second progression or death, the overall survival and the objective response rate, and the global health-related quality of life. So when they looked at the baseline characteristics were almost well matched in both the arms, the olaparib and the standard therapy group. Almost 57% of the patients were BRCA1 mutation positive, and around 41% were BRCA2 mutation positive. Around 50% were hormone receptor positive, and around 50% were triple negative. So when they looked at the primary endpoint, the PFS by the individual committee, the patients in the olaparib arm showed a 42% reduction in the risk of progression or death compared to the physician's choice of chemotherapy arm. So the hazard ratio was 0.58 with a significant p-value of 0.0009. So you can see the separation of the curves in the PFS Kaplan-Meier curve. It was 14.5 months versus 14.1 months the median duration. At 12 months, it was 25.9 months versus 15 months in the treatment of physician's choice. Now, when they looked at the OS analysis, at 64% maturity, the OS was around 19.3 months versus 17.1 months with a hazard ratio of 0.9. And if they look at the predefined subgroup analysis, the patients who didn't receive prior first-line chemotherapy, they did significantly well. They had a significant OS advantage over the other when they received the olaparib in the second or the third line. So 22.6 months versus 14.7 months. And when they looked at the efficacy of this data, they saw that the olaparib has the potential to prolong the chemotherapy-free interval with this benefit being maintained after subsequent treatment. So if you look over here, whenever they used the olaparib, there was definitely a difference in the chemotherapy usage of the chemotherapy. 2.8 month difference, it increased to 4.2, 5.2 month difference. So the olaparib usage gave a subsequent later progression. And if you looked at the adverse event summary, adverse events were relatively almost in the grade 1 toxicity, around 60% of the patients had grade 1 to 2 toxicities in the olaparib arm. In the treatment of physician's choice, it was around 46%. The grade 3 toxicities were around 35%, whereas in the chemotherapy arm, it was around 50.5%. Adverse events leading to drug discontinuations were around 5%. And the median duration of treatment was around 8.2 months in the olaparib arm versus 3.5 months in the chemotherapy arm. The most important adverse event was nausea and vomiting, followed by fatigue. So if you look over here, nausea almost in more than 50% of the patients had nausea, followed by around vomiting around 22%, and also anemia and neutropenia, and fatigue in 19%. Some patients also reported symptoms like pyrexia and other elevation of the liver enzymes in a very few patients. So this profile is similar to the toxicity profile, safety profile seen in ovarian cancer patients. Looking at the treatment emergent adverse event or serious adverse events, There were around treatment discontinuation in less than 5% of patients who were treated with olaparib. Almost 35% of the patients who received olaparib received dose interruptions, and 25% received dose reductions due to the treatment-related adverse events. But relatively, it was well tolerated. The nausea vomiting also was well managed with the antiemetics. And if you look at the patients at the time of data cutoff, only around 13% of the patients were still ongoing with the treatment. 87% had discontinued treatment because most of them had a disease, objective disease progression. This is expected because this is used beyond two lines of therapy, and that too in the triple negative breast cancer. Now, when they looked at the global health-related quality of life, it favored the patients treated with the olaparib compared to the treatment of physician's choice. There was a statistically significant difference suggesting a clinically meaningful benefit for patients who received the olaparib. So the global health-related quality of life was measured on a 100-point scale, and the mean baseline score was around 63. And there was a significant benefit seen with the olaparib arm compared to the treatment of physician's choice. Also, the time to deterioration of the global health-related quality of life also favored the olaparib arm compared to the treatment of physician's choice. You can see here, the curve is relatively much better with the olaparib compared to the one with the chemotherapy arm. So when can we use PARP inhibitors in this patient's journey? So all HER2-negative metastatic breast cancer patients are eligible for treatment with Lynparza if they are germline BRCA mutant and they have received chemotherapy earlier. It can be in the neoadjuvant, adjuvant, or the metastatic setting. So you have to test all your patients of HER2-negative metastatic breast cancer patients, because you can keep them or give them a newer option of olaparib as a newer treatment option. So as this algorithm shows, in a triple negative breast cancer patients, when they are no longer appropriate for endocrine therapy, we'll usually go with the chemotherapy in the metastatic setting. If they are hormone receptor positive, then you will challenge with the endocrine therapy. And if they progress on that endocrine therapy, you will go with the second line, maybe fulvestrant, or you will add a CDK4 inhibitor. So in this patients, when they are HER2 negative and hormone receptor positive or triple negative, always consider doing a germline BRCA mutation testing, because at present we can use the olaparib for such patients. See, overall conclusions for the Olympiad study was there was a 42% reduction in the risk of disease progression or death with the use of olaparib over the treatment of physician's choice. There was a 49% reduction in the risk of death when olaparib was administered as the first line in the metastatic breast cancer patients over chemotherapy. And it is generally well tolerated. The serious adverse events were only around 16.6% in the olaparib arm versus 16.5% in the treatment of physician's choice. It is consistent with the other safety profile seen of olaparib in the ovarian cancer, what we are already using. And there was a positive benefit of olaparib in the germline BRCA mutated patients with the HER2 negative metastatic breast cancer. The other advantage, it's the only oral therapy which is of convenience to the patient. And at present, NCCN recommends olaparib for BRCA mutation positive metastatic breast cancer. So with this, I will end my talk. Thank you for a patient listening.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you very much. Okay. Kashish, we have anybody else? Any comments or anything to be there before we move on to the panel discussion?
No, ma'am. After ma'am's talk is the panel discussion.
We just finished. Kashish, anything else to be done?
No, ma'am. It's your We can have the panel discussion, ma'am.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Okay. Anybody wants to have any comments? Please feel free to chip in now, and then we will proceed with the panel discussion. I'll share the screen. Okay. So I invite my panelist, Dr. Mansi Kanderia, medical oncologist from Bangalore. Mansi, you are there? Dr. Santhia, a medical oncologist again from Bangalore. Kakoli Lakhar, medical oncologist, Bangalore. Kakoli, you are there? Santhia, you are there? Okay, Dr. Vindhya Vasini from Hyderabad, medical oncology. Dr. Akila from Coimbatore.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Akila. Nice to hear your voice. Okay, Dr. S. Jayanti from Hyderabad.
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Okay, Sangeeta.
I'm there, ma'am.
Okay, Namrata. Dr. Namrata. Shimoga. From Shimoga. Okay, whoever has not joined, feel free to join in. Okay, and feel free to stop me because it is more of a discussion rather than a talk. Okay, so let's look into how do we go about with an advanced ovarian cancer. Okay, so we start with Akila. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah,
how do you approach and how do you define that patient is can be optimally bulked and cannot be bulked? What are the criteria? How do you define them?
I think first thing is routine CT abdomen and pelvis. When they saw any nodes, ascites, or mental deposits, liver surface infiltration, and any other organ infiltration or nearby. So which is more than stage 2A, probably I think we should consider neoadjuvant.
Okay, what about ascites?
Yes,
ascites. Dr. Gandhi, is ascites a contraindication? But there are some surgeons who said ascites is not a contraindication. Dr. Jayanti?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, this is the call of the surgical oncologist. Your surgical colleague who is willing to operate, ascites usually is not a contraindication. But most of them would prefer to give an adjuvant chemo, then go ahead with this interval cytoreduction.
Yes. Yeah. So ascites. So the surgical criteria are subjective because in a high volume center where we are have a lot of expertise, surgeons do take up advanced cancers, and those who do not feel that cannot be taken up, it is better. Now the definition of complete R0 is there. Now initially it was 0.5 and 1 centimeter residue. Now there is nil residue as far as ovarian cancer is concerned. Now before we move on to other aspects of discussion, Dr. Vindhya is there? Dr. Vindhya, now what is do you advise, suppose the patient is yours and you are sending them, any role of HIPEC? Any of the surgical oncologists,
not in the upfront setup, ma'am, maybe in the recurrence setting where complete cytoreduction,
not in the upfront setting, suppose tumor rupture, mucinous, ovarian carcinoma, is it documented or it is a standard of care? Anybody can take the question.
I think now, ma'am, I have most of our surgeons who are referring us, you know, as soon as we finish the neoadjuvant surgery and there's significant residual peritoneal disease, they've started offering HIPEC. I think they have new data for HIPEC actually.
Do you think that HIPEC is approved?
With the present situation, I think there is new data coming from HIPEC where they have significant peritoneal disease in situ. HIPEC does help them. So I think they have a lot of surgical oncologists now, wanting for HIPEC.
Yeah, surgical oncologists are pushing the HIPEC, but yes, there's no survival benefit. So look into the...
Comment, madam.
Yes, doctor.
I think if your histology is something not epithelial, like a mucoid or signet ring, HIPEC, I think we should be given a shot.
Yes, yeah, that is some aspect. If it is a mucinous, like how they do for colorectal, mucinous, appendicular, yes, mucinous does have a role. But remember, this HIPEC, it's a long procedure, 8 hours, 10 hours surgery, cost is involved, and post-operative care is also very good and long due. Shiram surgery. And in a country like us, how many centers are able to do HIPEC? I'm not sure. And I, if you see the guidelines, still not HIPEC is not yet a standard of care until and unless you have a mucinous deposit.
Ma'am, can I make a comment?
Everybody, please feel to talk. That's it.
Yeah. Ma'am, can I make a comment, please?
Yes, please.
Yeah, so we do have some positive data from the Dutch trials initially, but they have not been made standard of care because they were not reproducible. And now we have many more options for maintenance. So though tolerability, I have myself seen a lot of patients with HIPEC, the tolerance is okay. It's not as bad as intraperitoneal chemotherapy, but the advantage isn't much and the cost is much more. So I would definitely, in fact, now with PARP inhibitors, I don't think we should be considering HIPEC as medical oncologists. It will still be the standard of care for surgical oncologists for a long time. I do believe that.
Yeah, I also agree. They are trying to push the HIPEC. Any discussion, ma'am, HIPEC, okay, they will make a big thing. But you are right, did not have much change. Rather, the maintenance therapy has brought us more comfortable, good quality of life and extension of the progression-free survival. Okay, again, you brought in a question. I want somebody else to answer also. Mansi, Sandhya, intraperitoneal chemotherapy, when will you give, whom will you give, do you practice? Anybody?
So I used to, during my training, we've given it in a lot of patients, but again, now I don't think it is feasible and we do have better options. It is quite difficult for the patient as well as for the doctors. It's not an easy procedure. So in my current practice, intraperitoneal has no role, but I have used it earlier.
Yes, but if you see the guidelines, still intraperitoneal chemotherapy is there, but it is there and it differs from center to center and it has its own side effects. Not many people are able to do it. It has day one, day eight, but yes, in high center, but still it holds good. There is a, when you have some residue left behind, after a complete cytoreductive surgery, that's the place where you use it. Okay, the solo data. What do you think? Anybody, please give your comments. Yeah, tell me.
I think solo data is definitely a promising one, ma'am.
No,
any?
Okay, thank you. Yes, okay, Dr. Akira.
I think the solo data.
Will you use it for your patients, and whom will you use it?
Definitely, I'll use it if they are BRCA mutated, and if logistic issue is not there, as in maintenance therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. You have seen that there is a 48% progression. Okay. Take the original. Okay. And there is a difference in the from 21% to 48%, there is an improvement in the progression and a median follow-up. And if you see the FS2, there is 30%, 30.9% maturity and in second line. Now, again, quick question again to any of the panelists, take it. Now, how do you on the tissue, how will you do the BRCA testing? And if it is first line, do you, and if it is second line, do you test it? And how do you go about? Anybody, please. Dr. Sandhya, Dr. Kakoli, and Dr. Narmata, you can take it. How will you test it? Dr. Sandhya is there? Kakoli is there?
No, ma'am. Dr. Sandhya and Dr. Kakoli are not there.
Okay. What about Dr. Namrata?
Dr. Namrata and Dr. Maya also will not be joining, ma'am.
Okay, so all of them. So we have only Vindhya, Akila, Jayanti, and Sangeeta.
Ma'am, we have Dr. Mansi as well.
Ah, Mansi is also there. Dr. Sangeeta, you can take it. How will you do the BRCA testing?
So usually I think we already had a discussion. I think Sudha ma'am had presented it very well. So we always have to prefer both germline and somatic testing. So it is preferable that, you know, when you're looking for a germline, when you're looking for a somatic testing, yeah, tissue sample. A germline testing could be tested both on the tissue and the blood sample. So, but I think the percentage, like already ma'am mentioned, that there is a, you know, there, if you're looking only for a germline, there are chances of around 7 to 9% of missing of somatic. And similarly, you know, when you're checking only for somatic, you may again miss germline. So I think you will have to send both a tissue and a blood sample if required for both germline and somatic testing at the baseline.
Okay, both the blood as well as the tissue for both the germline. Yes, please.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you. Ma'am, can you make your slides full screen? And also, ma'am, are you moving the slides? Because currently we are on the first slide.
Yes. No, I'm moving. I'm with the fourth or fifth slide.
Ma'am, can you make the slide full screen?
I have made it full screen only. Okay, I'll
ma'am, to us it's visible. Ma'am, can you reshare your slides again?
I'll reshare it. Okay.
And ma'am, request you to also involve our speakers. We have Meher ma'am who's there. Even Poonam ma'am is there logged in. We can probably involve them as well.
Oh God, what are my slides got? 1 minute. Yes. Okay. Now, can you see it?
Yes, ma'am. We can see the slides, ma'am. Can you make it full screen?
It's full screen.
Not on our end, ma'am. Ma'am, can you change the next slide?
I'm changing. I'm changing 5 slides.
Ma'am, we're still on the first slide.
Okay. Then what should we do?
Ma'am, on your screen...
Okay.
Ma'am, on your screen, are you able to get an option where it says that you need to edit the presentation or anything?
No. Okay, thus I'm trying to do it again, see?
Yeah.
Okay, just 1 minute. Okay, just I'll not share this structure. What about now?
Yes, ma'am. Now the slides are moving also, and they're full screen as well.
Okay, fine. So we go to our speakers over here, Dr. Sudha, Dr. Meher Lakshmi, even Dr. Anu, Smita. So what testing do you do for the BRCA1, BRCA2? Do you do the HRR testing also? And if it is first line, as well, recurrent case. Anybody, please.
I would
As of now, ma'am, this is Dr. Meher.
Yes,
we are not, in our center, we are not doing HRD testing. We are doing only BRCA mutation. That too, mainly I'm sending mainly for germline mutation, madam. Not somatic as of now.
Okay, only you are doing germline?
Yes, yes.
Okay, not somatic.
Not okay. Somatic.
Okay, rest of the people, what about Sudha, Dr. Anu, Smita? Dr. Anu Sudhan and Dr. Sudha.
Ma'am, all three speakers have logged.
Okay, logged.
Ma'am, we have Dr. Poonam.
Dr. Poonam, please. Dr. Poonam?
Ma'am, I think if tissue is available, I would prefer somatic also.
Somatic as well as this. Okay. Now, if it is a first line, yes, definitely you will do. What about second line? Patient has recurred. What will you do?
Germline.
Anybody else? Anybody wants to differ from what Dr. Akila has said?
Ma'am, I generally do germline in the first line, especially if the patient is young and there is a good family history. And only when the germline is negative, I send for a tissue somatic testing. And the same thing I do in the second line as well. I generally prefer, because in case there is a very strong family history, then germline itself generally gives us an answer.
What about Dr. Jayanti, Dr. Akila, and Dr. Sangeeta?
Dr. Jayanti here, ma'am. Yes, please. We always advise all patients at diagnosis germline mutation. Hmm. We usually don't do a somatic thing on the tissue, but the patient recurs. If you have already done your BRCA test in the first line, we usually ask for a somatic BRCA, and if they can afford, even HRD can be done.
Okay, HRR, that is, can be done. Yes, HRR. But then there is some data to say that in a second line, do you really
One more correction. When the patient had responded to platinum therapy, then I insist them to get the HRR test done.
Okay. HRR test done. The brackenness of the tumor will be revealed. Okay. And if you have to de novo start a PARP inhibitor in second line, do you need the BRCA testing?
Don't need it.
First line, yes, definitely you need to do it. Maybe. But second line, it is not.
Second line, especially if we don't have niraparib as of now, but when we do have, we would be more confident in using it in all patients, irrespective of the mutation. But olaparib, I would still prefer doing BRCA, because the benefit is much more in BRCA. And we've not tested it really in patients who are wild type BRCA.
Correct. Yes, you are right. In niraparib, even in rucaparib also. Rucaparib has good data, and you say second line, don't do any of the testing. So that's it. This slide tells us that please consider HRD testing, okay, because patient likely to get, and it's the same protocopy as that what we are doing in the prostate cancer cohort A, cohort B, where we looked into another 14 genes that would help us to give us the time. Now, again, quickly to all the panelists now, at what point of time is your BRCA one you're going to introduce into the patient's treatment armamentarium? Anybody, please? Akita, Jayanti, yes, Dr. Jayanti, Dr. Santa.
So I think, ma'am, with the data upcoming, so we know that if there is a mutation, so even in the first line, we definitely can, give it as a maintenance. And then second line, or, in a recurrent setting where they have received multiple lines of therapy, definitely. And probably, if they have probably more than 3 lines, even as a 4th line, single agent also would be facing the lineup. So,
So it's inoperable stage 3, residual disease, stage 4, recurrent metastatic setting, you are fine with using a maintenance. Now, do you want to use only the single maintenance, or would like to add anti-VEGF along with that?
So VEGF, yes, so we have the data about the Palo trial where you have combined the Ola with bevacizumab, which had shown significant benefit. So it was also regardless of the BRCA status. So I think that was the first line maintenance. There was some definite benefit. So if feasible, well, probably we could add them.
Mansi and Dr. Jayanti, what is your thought process?
Though we have data, ma'am, but... our financial constraints definitely don't let us use both. Even if they can afford one, we would be more than happy. So there is data. If insurance covers it, great. I would use both. But otherwise, I would prefer PARP inhibitor over bevacizumab.
Definitely, madam. Financial constraints comes with all of these, I think. So I would also agree with
that. We do have a generic, yes, but I agree, in a situation like India, to afford PARP inhibitors, I think less than 5% of the actual benefit.
Ma'am, can I add? This is Dr. Meher.
Yeah, Dr. Meher, please.
In patient with the SITs and effusions, I prefer bevacizumab, madam.
Yes.
In those patients with SITs. There we can try a combination. Though Restol, we can choose PARP inhibitor, but bevacizumab should be preferred in patient with SITs or effusions.
I also agree, because third space accumulation, these drugs are really good, and then we see massive reduction in that ascitic fluid formation. Okay, so that's something, yes, I do agree with you, and that's what we discussed. Nilaparib is seen in BRCA mutant, BRCA wild type, also the HRR mutant types. Okay, so olaparib plus bevacizumab significantly increases the progression free survival. Okay, when just the bevacizumab in the intent to treat population. Okay. Now, question to the panelists. What are the side effects have you observed when you used your PARP inhibitors?
Ma'am, this is Dr. Jayanti.
Yes.
I had a chance of using olaparib only for 2-3 patients. And that the commonest side effects were fatigue, nausea, and vomiting. The other thing was anemia. One of them even went on to develop MDS-like state. She had pancytopenia, and we had to stop the drug, wait for almost 4 weeks. Then she ultimately recovered, and marrow was done after some 3-4 weeks and was showing some hypoplasia. But down the lane, after 1-2 months, she has recovered. So that was among the few patients which I treated, one already developed MDS-like picture. So okay, most of them are manageable, but if you have even one patient, that is dreadful. That's all, because considering the cost, it's difficult to convince the patient.
Dr. Akila?
Akila ma'am, you'll have to unmute your mic.
Hello.
Yes, please. Your experience on the side effects of olaparib.
Ma'am, I have not really seen major side effects.
Okay.
I mean, common side effects which were manageable. I've just used it in 2 patients.
Okay. So, anything specific?
No, not really major side effects.
Hmm.
Okay.
Fatigue is something unique sometimes, and some patients have to stop or reduce the dose just because of the fatigue. That's what my experience has been with a limited number of patients for olaparib.
Okay. So if you see the 2020 treatment paradigm, the frontline therapy for ovarian cancer, so we have the 2 drugs with us, paclitaxel carboplatin and bevacizumab. When you have effusion, you have extensive disease, metastatic disease, operable disease, and then also there is an option of adding the PARP inhibitors upline and then continue either PARP inhibitors or bevacizumab or PARP plus bevacizumab. So the thing is there too, how to be increase the progression-free survival, and we have come a long way and from starting from 5 months and now 5 months to 37 months is what we have seen. So any comments from our panelist, the journey in ovarian cancer, and do you think you will be able to give it to everybody?
No, ma'am. No. I think practically only not even 10% of our patients.
Will not be too.
Yeah.
Even paclitaxel also, we are finding it difficult to give it to all the patients. Yes. Okay. Again, question to the panelist. How long do you continue maintenance?
If ma'am, this is Dr. Jayanti. If the patient doesn't have any side effects and she's tolerating, we would like to continue at least if the first line maintenance would be at least for 2 years of olaparib.
Or till progression, if you are doing it in a metastatic setting. Okay. Okay. And anybody else?
I used only second line, madam. One patient for 1 year, and the second patient is still on. I thought of continuing till progression, till toxicity or progression.
Toxicity or progression. Dr. Poonam, I think we have done with the slides, and that's my last slide. Expert comments from you, and I'll also check the chat box. No, there's no question today in the chat box. I think all of us did very well. Dr. Poonam, couple of comments of how to go about with PARP inhibitors in ovarian tumor, and before we sign off for today.
So, thank you very much, Dr. Anita. It was a very well-organized symposium, and thank you so much for allowing me to participate today. So, today's symposium focused on personalized therapy of cancer, especially ovarian and breast cancer. We had an excellent talk about testing of BRCA mutations, whom to test, when to test, where to test, what to test, and also the use of PARP inhibitors in ovarian cancer, first line, second line. A beautiful talk by Dr. Smita about the updates in treatment of breast cancer. Whatever we say, BRCA and PARP inhibitors are all set out to change the natural disease course of ovarian cancer, definitely. And also probably in breast cancer. Actually, our experience of PARP inhibitors in breast cancer, at least my experience, is much less compared to what data is there for ovarian cancer. But looking at whatever we are seeing as a targeted treatment and against the BRCA gene mutation, they are definitely out for something. And I think time will tell us where we are in future with the PARP inhibitors. Personalized therapy means the right drug, right patient, and right time. Some things we know, and we are on the learning curve for some. So it was a good knowledge sharing platform. And I'm sure as our experience increases, we will keep learning from each other. And I think that's it. Thank you very much. Good night to you all.
Yes, thank you very much. I think it was a very fruitful discussion. Actually, we have learned how to wisely use these drugs in the right patient to get the right benefit. Request to the company, make the patient assistance program, because we have many patients with the data so amazing, should be able to hand it over to many of the cases. Okay, thanks to all the panelists, speakers.
Thank you.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Kavina,
thank you.
AstraZeneca, Freedom from Cancer. Thank you very much for bringing all of us together. Stay safe, stay connected. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.